Hi, I'm Paul Jehle, Senior Pastor of the New Testament Church. And in this introductory session and this presentation, I want to just give you a little glimpse as to the history of the New Testament Church of Cedarville, its history and its mission, established in 1901, and what makes us distinct and unique here in South Plymouth. And this may help you be able to understand a little bit more about who we are and about what we desire to do. You know, it's interesting that it was the Pilgrim arrival in 1620 that we're linked to. In fact, all Protestant churches are here in America and particularly in New England. And we have done quite a bit of study about the Pilgrims themselves, but their form of government, their covenant, and what brought them here to the New World. But from an historic respect, the Pilgrims embody that Protestant Reformation that we can date our lineage from. Their alliance of peace only within a few months with the Wampanoag in March of 1621 also is very significant to the history of our own church, because that peace not only paved the way for future ministry of bringing the gospel among the natives, but also doing so in such a way with that alliance that would bear great fruit over 200 years later in the history of our own church. Very significant that these two events begin to spark and set the stage for churches all over New England. It's important to recognize that within 15 years of the Pilgrims coming, they entertained Roger Williams. He was the founder of Providence, Rhode Island, and in many respects, he is revered as having one who had real heart for building relationships with the natives here in the area. And he did so, and he made contact with the Pondville Herring Pond Native community in 1635 when he was visiting Plymouth Plantation, and he preached a number of months in Plymouth with the Pilgrims. Only 2 years later, Richard Bourne from Sandwich established a church among the Bourndale tribe, which is right down Herring Pond Road today and near the Red Schoolhouse on the other side of Herring Pond Road. And then this set the stage for the July 21, 1669 deed. This deed is when the Pilgrims purchased land on the Herring River near where our church is today for the cedar trees. Those cedar trees were evidently growing where the White Cliffs Golf Course is on the side of the road where our church is. And that's why that this whole area became known as Cedar Swamp. You see the image of the Herring Pond Wampanoag tribe, which is very active and still active, very close to where our church is. And recognizing that this interrelationship between the native Wampanoag and the English descendants and those of the Pilgrims is very significant in the history of our church and important to recognize in that regard. There's a plaque down at the end of the, near the Barndale tribe, down the end of Long Herring Pond Road, that is, as you go toward the canal, which depicts this first meeting house erected by Richard Bourne and Thomas Tupper. It says the Burying Hill, site of the first meeting house for Indians at Plymouth Colony. And it was established by Richard Bourne, he was from Sandwich, and Thomas Tupper, that was his next door neighbor in Sandwich. And in 1637. And this is, again, a very powerful thing. It's the first Indian meeting house. And the goal of Richard Bourne was to have natives actually become the pastors. And that will significantly play into the history of our church. About 1850, the third meeting house was established. And that third meeting house was in Pondville. Pondville is very close to our church. The second meeting house had to be abandoned. It was up on a hill overlooking the river, the Herring River, before it ever became Herring Pond. And that Herring River, they had so many snakes intertwined in the timbers and around that church that had to be abandoned. They ended up meeting in the parsonage for some time. That's the second meeting house. Because you see, there was a revival and an awakening among the natives in this area, receiving the gospel. And because of that, these Indian meeting houses are very significant. The first, again, being the 1637 one in Bourndale, the second one, which no longer exists, and the location is a bit uncertain, along the Herring River, now Herring Pond, and then the third one. And the way it looks today, if you're driving down Herring Pond Road from our church, it'll be on the left-hand side. And that is the Pondville Native Church. And the Herring Pond Native community still meets there on a regular basis each week. And this is significant because in 1850, when this church was founded, it was the result of a revival going on right there along the banks of the Herring River. It is recorded that 12 natives were baptized in the Herring River. And this was huge. There weren't that many people around at the time. And this became a place where Sunday school got started and a church got planted. And it was a native church, which meant that natives pastored. And they began to pastor the white folk in the area because they did not have a church where we were in South Plymouth, which is South Plymouth today. And that's important and significant. And it's important and significant as the legacy of Richard Bourne and even Roger Williams, that they had great respect for the natives and wanted them to govern themselves and not be ruled over by the whites, which unfortunately took place in many instances. And then the events that took place that we chronicle, it's quite interesting. Because evidently from that 1850 mini revival along the Herring River, the understanding of Christianity continued to slowly increase and up the road. And there were some, as it was written in some cases, some black backslidden white fishermen in the area around where our church exists today. And there was an evangelist by the name of Tempe or Temperance Nightingale, who would go up and down the street. And in the book, the original cover is here on the page, 1881 edition, Sarah Pratt McLean came from Connecticut and was a teacher in the schoolhouse. And at that time it was a white schoolhouse. And she was teaching. And when she was teaching in that year of 1880, 1881, she chronicled many events that took place along the street called The Lane, which is called Long Pond Road today. And many of those things were aspects of revival. Now, unfortunately, her reputation is tainted because this book, when she published it in 1881, Sarah McLean, she actually published it with the original names. Now, that's great for historians, but it is not very good at all because that book became the first libel suit in American history. Libel suit of literature because those individuals, she changed some of the ages and facts and romanticized some issues, and that went to court. And damages were sought. And so every subsequent edition of Cape Cod Folks has obviously the original names no longer in it. But some of the things that she mentioned in that book were corroborated, and that was a mini revival going on. On the bottom right, you see the painting of Temperance Nightingale right next to me. But also, there was a right behind that country store, which was along the lane and almost across from where our church exists today, was called the Ark, that building behind it. And that was a family that would entertain the young people, and they would sing through the Ira Sankey hymnal in a night. They would constantly be singing, and they were growing in the Lord. And it was Tempe Nightingale, Sarah Pratt McLean in the novel begins with Tempe Nightingale saying, "Run for the ark, you poor lost sinners, run for the ark, my unconverted friends." Here she is going up and down the lane and in the red schoolhouse, which we know is the red schoolhouse today, which of course back then was white. She was saying, "Run for the ark, go to the prayer meeting. Go to the place where young people and some adults are singing and praising God." And there's this element of Christianity woven through this novel, which recognizes that Sarah Pratt McLean was pretty honest that she did not know the Lord, but was greatly impacted by teaching there. Though she wrote this satirical novel, which in some cases thwarted some facts, we recognize that we realize that there was this revival going on in 1880. Among the youth. So what happens 15, 20 years later? You see in the upper right of this page, the tombstone for Stanton and Temperance Nightingale, which is right near our church off Lakewood Drive. This is a phenomenal piece of history that leads to the establishment of our church. Now, I want you to understand that this was a mini revival among the white folk, but the whites, when they would become Christians, they would attend the Pondville Church. most of them walk down that road, which we call Herring Pond, a road today, and they would walk down and go to the Pondville Church, which was pastored by a Native American. It was the Native Americans who had become Christians that discipled those individuals that would grow up and found what we know today as the New Testament Church. We are indebted to the Native Americans and their embrace of Christianity for our existence as a church. And over the years, I have been able to, myself personally, was honored to participate in some Native funerals, and others who had been related to our church, attended our church, and were very much a part of it. So we have tremendous honor and respect for those individuals who paved the way with receiving the gospel and then shepherding the new converts up and down the lane, Long Pond Road, as they became Christians. And here, right behind that store and in and around that store, the Ark, nicknamed for the Ark of Safety from Noah's time, of run to there, find Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and then begin to worship him and let him change your life. This was the immediate inspiration for the founding of the church. Now, here is an amazing panoramic photograph that was actually given to us as a church by Grace Nye. Now, Grace Nye had actually gone to school in the Red Schoolhouse in the early 1900s, became a graduate of Bourne High School. Her picture is there. And in this panoramic view from the Herring River side, before it was a pond, in the early 1900s, a dam was put at the other end. And this is what filled out Herring Pond today. It's much larger, of course, now than it was then. But you can see faintly in this picture, I've enlarged a section toward the middle, the Cedarville Schoolhouse, which was built in 1874 and had been used in the 1870s. And then, of course, through that time that Sarah Pratt McLean came and then wrote the novel, this schoolhouse, you notice that there were not many trees at the time right there. There were several roads, which all are still in existence there, which converge right by that schoolhouse. And then you're moving up the lane are those original houses in the 1900s. You have to keep in mind that after this novel, 20 years before, Cedar Swamp, which became known as Cedarville, became a tourist attraction. People who had read that novel all came to Plymouth and then came down by horse, buggy, whatever the way they could come, in order to visit this place, to visit the homes and meet the people that had been named in the novel. They were not too fond of having a lot of visitors at that time. It was a quaint village. They had their own ways, and we're looking at this, and this caused some a real problem and real angst. And not everybody became a Christian, and there was bitterness between the sides of those who were Christians and those who were not, as we might imagine. At the same time, the light of the gospel was clearly planted. And initially, right behind that white schoolhouse, soon after this picture was taken, this panoramic picture, the foundations for the New Testament Church, which is known today as the New Testament Church, was founded, because that church had probably its first church service July 4th, 1901, with its first building between 1904 and 1910 being built. And that was a hall initially behind the Red Schoolhouse and then that church. Grace and I wrote this letter to myself and Dave Calhoun, Dave Papa Calhoun, who was very instrumental in the revival of the church. She said this: about 1900, when the little village of Cedarville consisted of some 15 houses, each with a few acres of cleared land around it where there were orchards and vegetable gardens, grain growing, four women were one evening washing the dishes from the evening meal when one expressed the wish for a church which would be their own in their own village. Heretofore, they walked to Pondville, 1.5 miles for church services twice each Sunday. Each agreed that they were willing to work endlessly to bring to reality what they sought. And they did. From church suppers, they raised the money, and they finally were able to establish a church in 1901 and actually build a building. Now, if you look at the picture to my right, up to my left and your right, you see the Cedarville Community Bible Church. Probably the first hall or foundation for that, well, that was a separate building in 1904, but that building probably was founded in 1910. That church, that we date it 1904 because of the first separate hall from the schoolhouse at the time. It's kind of diagonal behind that. Of course, it does not exist there now. This was the first church in Cedarville. It was a church where individuals, some of whom are still in our church today, were associated with and remember this church, this building. There's a plaque in our lobby, if you were to go in the front of our church, and it has the names of those women that Grace and I say began to work together to raise the funds to found the church. And remember, these individuals had been greatly affected by a revival taking place in the 1880s. And Temperance Nightingale with her husband Stanton were very much a part of that and leaders in that, but they were shepherded and discipled by native Christians and pastors in the area. You see right above me is Dave Calhoun, Dave Papa Calhoun. He passed away in 1998, but here he stands with the original Alfred Nye Bell. We call it the Nye Bell because Alfred Nye, husband of Grace Nye, is the one who donated this to the church. And he donated it to the church in the 1960s, and it's dated July 4, 1901. Now, we think it may be the designation for the first church service, but we recognize it also, of course, is for the birth of America and Independence Day. And we've always looked at that as significant and not merely symbolic, that we as a church were called to teach the true Christian history of the independence of this nation, and at the same time, preach the gospel and serve the community as that original Cedarville Community Bible Church did. It was the center of the community. It was the place where people went when they had needs, physical needs, as well as spiritual needs. And we believe that legacy is to continue today, that we want to be that kind of individual that serves other people and preaches the gospel of salvation, that one can know Jesus Christ and come to know him and have a direct relationship with God. Now, it's interesting to note that that time, the Alfred Nye also gave land up the lane, or now Long Pond Road, where the original church, where our church sits today, but it looked different. And built in 1962, it was built by Dave Papa Calhoun from a church in the Wildwood kit. And here, this tiny, quaint church in the town of Cedarville, South Plymouth, this is a painting of that original church. In fact, that church, as it was there, was used from about 1963. It was dedicated and used right up until 1982. Now, in 1982, an addition was put out. If you look at the painting to the right of that, you'll notice that not only was a flagpole given a few years later by a graduating class, the class of 1988, in honor of it, but a handicap ramp was off the side of the building, and we had the addition built out. And that was to add classrooms and to expand the sanctuary. For at this time, under the able ministry of Jim Pierce and his wife, Diana, the church rapidly grew at this time. And this was powerful because during this time from 1983 and on, the church continued to expand. We were actually running out of room in the 1990s. And in the 1990s, toward the end, Grace Nye, upon her death, bequeathed to the church a large gift for the expansion of the sanctuary and for school classrooms that our Christian school might expand as well. You see, the New Testament church, as we know it today, has a tremendous legacy in education as well. In fact, one of the key individuals, the wife of David Calhoun, Papa Calhoun, Mimi or Marjorie Calhoun, taught kindergarten for the town of Plymouth in the church. That original church behind the Red Schoolhouse. Not only that, but the Christian school founded in 1980 became a staple part of the New Testament church in training the next generation with a kindergarten beginning through fifth grade and then all the way through high school. A classical tutorial school teaching a biblical kingdom worldview and training children how to think logically and upon premises and applying their faith to every area of life. That new sanctuary in 1999 expanded that ministry and those classrooms, and that's, of course, the building you see today. Now, interestingly enough, We have some murals painted in our hallway that depict the complete history of Christianity. And one of them is the church behind me as a ship. And the Bible talks about a church as a ship. But what are our distinctives? What are the things that we hold dear that you will learn about if you begin to become involved in the New Testament church? First is what an interesting phrase called Reformed Charismatic Theology. See, it was in the 1970s that the individuals at that time, it was a conservative Baptist church. We recognize that the community, Cedarville Community Bible Church, almost went out of existence in the 1950s until Dave Calhoun and his wife Marjorie moved in to South Plymouth. And they got dramatically converted on Easter Sunday. And they began to preach the gospel. And this was phenomenal. But 20 years later, they received the baptism in the Holy Spirit and began to recognize that supernatural gifts are given to people, and not just miracles, but gifts of being able to live the Christian life. And the power of the Holy Spirit began to be emphasized. And through that time, as I began to come to the church and eventually became senior pastor, I brought a flavor of Reformed theology, historic classical theology from the Reformation. Most Protestants adhere to many of those points. It's not unique in that regard. But this blend of believing in the affirmation of the gifts of the Spirit, as well as a sound theology from the scriptures that guide that expression, has become part of what we believe. And you'll read more about that as you go through aspects of our church. You can read our statement of faith and how we apply those things. But one thing that we emphasize is covenant membership. And someone who wants to get really involved in our church will form a covenant, like they did in the book of Acts, where they recognized that they had a verbal covenant of some kind. And that's why when they went from one church to another, they could have a letter of recommendation based on their living of that character qualities. We ask that individuals maintain that character and a testimony. It's very important to us that when people are in the community and others, that those who have made a covenant commitment to our church emulate Christ in the way they portray themselves and their involvement in the community. Another aspect of our church, which is distinctive, is self-government by consent. We believe in the similar government to the Pilgrims. It'd be kind of characterized as a Presbyterian type of government, congregational base, with leadership and elders and deacons that govern. And at the same time, it means that there's self-government, that the membership has authority as members, and therefore they confirm by consent those who lead. Leaders don't just drop out of the sky. They often grow up within the church. People recognize their character. As senior pastor, I am voted on, confirmed by the membership on a regular basis because I recognize this, that I serve by their consent. And there's accountability of leadership. We see all kinds of problems that have happened in the church when individuals have no accountability to anyone, do not have to submit to anyone else. I am accountable to the government of the elders, and all the leaders in the church are accountable to the membership. And therefore we serve by their consent. And that not only protects us, it allows us to move boldly, to lead with concerted action, knowing that we are protected by that covenant. And that's important to recognize. And we believe that strongly. You'll recognize that we have from a practical standpoint, what we call the three legs of ministry. Three kinds of meetings, and there's all variations of these. One, worship. We all come together on Sunday mornings, and we gather and we worship together, hear the word of God articulated. And then we also believe in small group fellowships, often meeting in homes. And in this way, small groups, you get to know one another, could be centered around a Bible study, could be centered around merely fellowship, could be centered around a number of things, but it's a place to grow. And one of those aspects of focus is a third kind of meeting. And this is all articulated in our church constitution. And that's equipping of leaders and youth for the future. It doesn't have to be just teenagers or those in their 20s or 30s, though that's important if the church is going to continue in the future. But anyone at any age can be equipped to be able to distinctively serve in some area. And we believe that from these three areas, all kinds of ministries and gifts can be released. And you will see that as you get more involved in the New Testament church and some of the things that we're teaching. It's important to recognize that throughout the years, we've kind of adopted a slogan, neighborhoods to nations, that God wants us to make an impact through influence and service locally, right in our own neighborhoods, our own towns, and our own areas. We believe in training the next generation. So we believe in supporting those parents who wish to homeschool or that wish to send them to our Christian school or any other form, but we wish that the parents would remain involved in their child's education, the primary influencer, the primary tutor, even if they aren't, of course, the teacher that teaches all of them in every subject. We believe adults and youth should work together. They should work together in ministry. Not just parents and children, though that's where it begins, but then adults and young people in every facet of ministry. It will not be uncommon for you to find adults and youth, whether they're involved in worship team that ministers on Sunday morning, where individuals will give testimonies, young and old. We believe that God is moving in all ages. We believe in community service and investment. And we've done this more recently in our local food bank, supporting an historic organization in Pilgrim Progress in town, historic tours of the pilgrims, a way to serve the town. America's Hometown Thanksgiving Parade that takes place the weekend before Thanksgiving. We're very involved in that. And we're involved in general helping our neighbors and our neighborhoods in any way that we can. And of course, we also go to nations strategically, looking at seeing the kingdom of God manifest in strategic work among the nations. And we have various individuals we support in various nations of the world. And these nations, whether it's in Kenya, and we have contacts in Nigeria and in Central America and South America. And this is very huge to us. And this is something that we wish to continue to support. I welcome your interest in the New Testament Church. I welcome your interest in who we are. I look forward to seeing you on a Sunday, meeting you. And we just thank you for listening and watching. And we pray that you would want to continue and connect with us and connect in every way to see that your gifts could be released. Come, get to know us. We're just normal people. God has done a work in our life, saved us by his grace, and we're not worthy of it. We don't believe we earned it. We don't believe we're smart enough to figure out who God is. God revealed himself to us, and we realize that, you know, this is what happens when God can touch an individual's life in their mind, in their will, their emotions, bring self-control, change our habits, change who we are, then indeed we can influence other people by our testimony and our example, not by our control or manipulation. And this is how Christianity grows from one person to another. This is how God will move to meet your needs. And if you need Jesus, you can just come to him. You can pray at any time and ask him to come, reveal himself to you. Say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I just need you. And I want you to come into my life. Or you can come and talk to any one of us. But may God bless you. And may the mission and service of the New Testament Church continue long beyond our lives, that we might continue to serve our neighbors, bless others, and that they might know, and we all might know, who Jesus Christ is. May God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.